beside Carolina home.
Hello, I'm Ken Mann, and welcome to the town of Columbia on the Scuppernong River in northeastern North Carolina. Originally known as Elizabethtown, the town of Columbia was first incorporated by the North Carolina General Assembly in 1793. Let's find out more about what there is to see and do here, as well as talk to some of the people that call Columbia home. Hello, I'm Ken Mann.
Hello, I'm Helen Craddock, and welcome to the Tyrrell County Visitor Center in Columbia, North Carolina.
Well, thank you, Helen. What do we find in the Visitor Center?
We have information regarding all of northeastern North Carolina and Tyrrell County, and we also have information for the whole state. So you can find all kinds of information that you need to plan your vacation here.
Thank you, Helen. Next, we'll begin our tour by learning more about Columbia when we talk with Town Manager Rhett White. We're visiting with Rhett White. Rhett is the town manager here in Columbia. Rhett, it's good to have you with us.
Well, it's good to have you in Columbia.
I know there's a lot of folks that have never been to Columbia, and a lot of folks have only been through Columbia. They haven't stopped to spend a few minutes here. So tell us a little bit about the town.
Well, we think that there's a lot of reasons to stop. It's an interesting small town, and we're sitting at the end of Main Street on the Scuppernong River, and this is one of the things that we showcase, the river. We've got a wonderful boardwalk that walks along the river, so visitors can spend a few minutes or an hour or so walking along the waterfront. The Main Street has some interesting little businesses in it, including a dime store, a five and dime that will take you back, and a hardware store that will take you back to the mid-1900s, very much like I remember it when I was a youngster growing up here. Not much has changed as far as that's concerned, and it we hear people all the time talking about what a jewel that sort of thing is. We also have a walking historical tour in the town of about 20 homes that are on the National Registry tour, with another 20 or so homes, churches, and other structures that are significantly important from a historical standpoint. So we think there are a lot of reasons for people to stop in Columbia and spend some time in here and enjoy themselves.
We mentioned in the opening of the program that the town was chartered in the 1700s. How has the town developed and grown over the years and changed?
Well, the town grew up on the Scuppernong River, and of course all of the towns of that era, the late 1700s, early 1800s, the access was primarily by water, and that's what put it here on the Scuppernong River. The town benefited from the rich agricultural heritage of the area of Tyrrell County. The lumbering and the milling, for example, in the late 1800s, early 1900s, up to the mid-1900s, a couple of mills operated here. There was the Branning lumber operation, which was a major lumber operation, a milling operation right here in Columbia, in fact, from where we're sitting, just a few hundred yards from where we are. And that helped with the growth of the town up through World War II and the Korean War area. Like many towns of small towns of rural America and rural eastern North Carolina, the town declined some after the mid-1900s. Fortunately, and we're proud to say that we have at this point no vacancies, no boarded up businesses, no boarded up storefronts in town. And many people are rediscovering the town, and we think that's one of those positive things that we can say about the town at this time.
And when they rediscover the town, you've got some wonderful places to eat. I think there's some bed and breakfast in town.
Yes, we have some places for people to stay with bed and breakfast, a wonderful one right down Main Street and across from the Methodist Church. We do have some nice restaurants that offer breakfast, lunch, and dinner here in town, ice cream shops and that sort of thing as well. The river offers opportunities for boaters, and we see frequently sailboaters and powerboaters, more and more sailboaters, as they're enjoying the Albemarle Sound and doing a stop off maybe in Manio and also Edenton and across the Sound to Elizabeth City. spending one of their overnights here on the waterfront of Columbia.
I know later in the program we're going to share with the folks some other reasons to come by, explore nature, the arts.
Yes, we're proud of the fact that the town and county has recognized that one of the real advantages, opportunities if you will, is the ecotourism opportunities in the community. Being here on the water, if you look around this area, I feel safe in saying that we've got as great a diversity, for example, of amphibians and reptiles as you will find in the eastern part of North Carolina, right here within a few hundred yards of where we're sitting. We've also got, with the Pocosin Arts, a wonderful budding art community and emphasis on the arts, the crafts, the folk arts, and so forth. And that's another reason for people to be here and participate. We have slightly out of Columbia the Eastern North Carolina 4-H Center, which is another wonderful resource for organizations, businesses, corporations that are looking for a retreat location, want to bring their people for team building and those kind of activities as well.
And special events through the year.
Special events through the year. We have a wonderful, wonderful street festival in October. It's usually the weekend of Columbus Day weekend. It's a Saturday festival. The population of Columbia is 851 people. Last October, on that Saturday, we had over 8,000 people for the Scuppernong River Festival. And their activities on the water, their activities on the streets, has a lot of the trappings of a typical street festival, but some unique things as well, a big parade and a street dance at night, fireworks over the water. We'd love for people to come. And another festival that's developing on an annual or event that's developing is Rivertown Christmas, a three-day event at Christmas time that has involved the Hispanic community, which is quite sizable in the area, as well as the rest of the population in the area, of parades, cooking contests, decorating contests, posada, featuring this Hispanic community. All of these things are things that we point to with a great deal of pride.
Well, we look forward to seeing the rest of Columbia.
Well, we want you to, and thank you again for being with us.
Thank you, Ed.
Thank you.
One of the places you want to visit on your trip to Columbia is the museum, which is located in an old theater. Tom Stroud is with us. Tom is with the organization responsible for this museum, as well as some other great work here in Eastern Carolina. Tom, tell us about the organization and the theater.
The Partnership for the Sounds is the organization that runs the Columbia Theater. We also operate the North Carolina Estuarium in Washington and the Roanoke-Kashaw River Center in Windsor, North Carolina, all of which are devoted to environmental education about this region.
Tell us about this museum and the theater.
The Columbia Theater is a museum that concentrates on the farming, fishing, and forestry heritage of the Albemarle region. People have used the resources of this area for thousands of years, and we've got artifacts and exhibits that talk about that.
So it's in a sense conveying the life of the people that lived in and about the outdoors. This place is not as developed as other places, but at one time it was even less developed and more dependent on fishing and agriculture as a way of survival.
Exactly. You know, really up until recent decades. If you lived out here, there weren't many stores. You didn't just run down to the grocery store and pick up food. A lot of times, you know, you were growing it, you were catching it, you were killing it. That's how people fed themselves.
What are some of your favorite exhibits in the museum that convey that story?
Where we are right now is the main floor area, where we've got three sets. We sort of carried the movie set motif through, since this was an old theater, where we've got exhibits about fishing, about farming behind us, about forestry over here, that really show from decades ago and even hundreds of years ago some of the things that people used and how they made their living or survived by living off the land.
So are some of the exhibits here made with actual artifacts from those times?
Oh yeah, yeah. We had a collection day when we were getting the museum prepared, where we, you know, asked people, look in your attics, look in your barns and your sheds, and, you know, see if you have some things that would help us convey the information.
So if folks want to get an idea of how people used to live in this area and probably many other areas of the country at that time, they can come to this museum.
That's right.
What do you hope that they'll leave here with after they've had a chance to come see and experience this?
As much as anything, just to realize how people did depend so much on what they did at their homes. So, you know, whether they were growing crops or, you know, their own livestock or having to go out and hunt. And in this area, as you say, it's still not highly developed compared to a lot of other areas. We're growing. There's, you know, modern conveniences here now. But it wasn't too long ago that they really did have to depend on just what they could provide themselves with. And we'd love for, you know, whether it's the older generation or especially kids to come in and realize just what life was like for those people.
Thank you, Tom.
Okay, thank you, Ken.
We got all the woods, water, wetlands, and wildlife you could want. So it's a paradise if you like to get outside. Word sure enough out about that. People come from hundreds of miles just to hunt or fish or enjoy the scenery in Tyrrell County.
During your visit to Columbia, be sure to make time to stop by the Pocosin Arts Gallery. With me is Feather Phillips. She's the executive director. Now, I understand your name has changed a little bit.
Well, we added the descriptor folk school because it helps people understand better what we are. Pocosin Arts, if you don't know what the word Pocosin means, you might be a little confused. So we are Pocosin Arts Folk School.
Well, tell us, what is the Pocosin Arts Folk School?
Okay, we are an educational organization, nonprofit teaching organization. Our mission is to connect culture to the environment through the arts. So we look at the people of the Pocosin region. Who are they? Where did they come from? What are some of their traditional practices? How do they express themselves through the arts? And how does that give us a better understanding of this place and its people and how the place and the people connect?
What are some of the ways that people can participate? And what are some of the programs they can participate in?
Well, we accomplish our mission through classes and workshops. We have weekly classes in adult pottery, after school pottery for children. We have fiber arts programming, that'd be knitting, weaving, spinning, hand spinning. We have craft education programs that we do in a residency at the Eastern 4-H Center, and that's 4 days, 3 nights, and we hire nationally renowned artisans and teachers to help with that. And that program serves working artists and craftspeople, teachers, heritage tourism interpreters, somebody who wants to have blacksmithing as a part of their historic site, or hand spinning, or traditional pottery. So we do serve the history centers and heritage tourism interpreters. And then another wonderful market for us is lifelong learners. And we hear more and more from our tourism professionals that the baby boomers who are now hitting retirement want to experience something on their vacation. They're not passive travelers. They want to sit down and do something.
So people can come and participate even if they're not necessarily residents of Eastern North Carolina?
Absolutely. We have our retreat program has served people from 14 different states.
Wow. Your gallery is beautiful. Tell us about the gallery, what they find here, where this work came from, and I'm assuming they can take it home with them.
Yes, they can. The gallery is divided into two parts. The front of the gallery is a sales gallery. We offer the work of regional artists and craftspeople for sale. These are people all affiliated with our program. Either they have taught with us, they are students, or they are mentors, volunteers, supporters in some other way. And this is a determination that the Internal Revenue Service makes. So it's work offered on consignment, and a portion goes to the artist, and a portion goes to help support our mission. So the work you see is the handwork of our supporters. And in the back part of the gallery, we have a permanent exhibit of regional folk art, and that we've divided by culture. And so we show work of Native American, African American, European American, Mexican American, and we have a growing Vietnamese American population in this community. And we're hoping that through this permanent exhibit and calling local people together with their families, traditional and folk art, that we can open some lines of communication between cultures and provide a better understanding of each other.
Last but not least, help me understand the difference in folk art and other things that we would define as art, because I know that you see a difference there.
Oh, I do, absolutely. I have a passion for folk art. I think folk art often comes from the heart or maybe even the gut. It's people who have to make art because they have a need to express themselves. And it doesn't matter whether they've had any formal training, it doesn't matter whether they have expensive art supplies. If they need paint, house paint does just fine. If they need clay, they might dig it from the backyard. If they need wood, they might tear it off the back of an old barn. So it's people who make because they want to make, they love to make, they are not necessarily interested in the market. They mostly make for themselves, and sometimes the most honest communication comes through that. I'm also a fan of fine art and fine craft, people who work for years and train and study and practice, but there's something about folk art that cuts through and is a straight communicator.
It's the real thing.
I think so. Yeah, we're all about the real thing here.
Thank you, Father.
Okay, thank you, Ken, and I hope everybody will come to Columbia and enjoy it.
I'm sure they will.
Thank you.
Next to the Tyrrell County Visitor Center is the Pocosin Lakes National Wildlife Refuge Administration offices, and also the Walter B. Jones Senior Center for the Sounds. Annette Gibbs is with us, and she's going to tell us about the center. Annette?
The Walter B. Jones Center for the Sounds has been here for about 3 years. And the purpose of the center is to showcase Pocosin Lakes National Wildlife Refuge, which is in Hyde, Beaufort, and Tyrrell, and Washington counties. We have exhibits in there that you can see, no live animals, but we have an exhibit of a bear. And most people that come in just look at that bear and they miss the fact that there are snakes, and there's also a pitcher plant, and ducks and birds. So we like to point that out to them, make them see how many they can see. Also the red wolf. We have the red wolf was reestablished here in Tyrrell County along with Hyde and Dare counties. So we have that exhibit that we're very proud of. And we also have an exhibit of the red cockaded woodpecker, which is one of an endangered species. And also this area is known for the migratory birds that come through. And when you grow up here, you take those birds for granted because you don't realize that they don't have them everywhere. And so we have several different species of migratory songbirds that come all the way from South America, and even the tundra swan, which comes to this area all the way from Alaska. So we're a very unique area in all the wildlife that we have. This is a great opportunity to show it off.
Discover the outdoors, learn history, enjoy the arts, all right here in the town of Columbia. The next time your travels carry you through Eastern Carolina, stop by and spend a few minutes here. You'll be glad you did. I'm Ken Mann. Thank you so much for watching. Be sure to join us again next week for more people, places, and things from the Outer Banks in Northeastern North Carolina. May God bless you richly.
My heart will always be. Carolina.